Welcome to Monumental United Methodist Church in Old Town Portsmouth, where our vision for ministry is hands and hearts serving our neighbors. My name is Celeste Heath, and I'm the pastor here at Monumental. We're honored and thankful that you chose to worship with us today. Thank you for your generous gifts to support our ministry in our community and the world. You may give through our website or through your online banking bill pay option or through the mail. Our Wednesday night dinner program is going well. Each week we feed more people in our community who are in need. Thank you to our volunteers who are helping provide this nourishing meal. And a special thank you to Wendy and David Roan as they keep everything organized and everyone on track for this important mission to the homeless and working poor of our community. During the summer months, this online service may be a little off schedule. In order to give the worship team a little time of rest from our recording schedule, we'll be recording on Thursdays and Sundays, which means the worship service may not get online until Monday on some weeks. Thank you for understanding as we want to offer quality worship and get a little time to enjoy the summer. On Thursday, August the 1st, the Old Town Business Association is sponsoring a Red Cross blood drive at St. John's Episcopal Church. There is a desperate need for blood at this time. In June, the Red Cross was down in donations by 20,000, so all donations are critical. If you're able to give, please do so. As we think about gifts in this time of the summer, giving blood is giving the gift of life. Monumental will worship at Court Street Baptist Church next week, Sunday, August 4th. The online service will be recorded on Sunday in the beautiful Court Street Sanctuary. If you are able, please be sure to plan to be there. We had a wonderful service and lunch when Court Street came here at the end of June, and we want to continue this historic tradition by being a part of this combined worshiping congregation. Last week, we had a wonderful Christmas in July dinner theater. If you missed it, I hope that you will plan to be at the next dinner theater in December. We are currently in a worship series called How Does Your Garden Grow? The first week, fertile ground or dirt was our focus. Then our focus was on water and rain. Today, we will look to the skies for helping our physical and spiritual gardens grow. I want to thank those who make this online service possible and remind you of who they are. Reverend Ellen Comstock is our liturgist. Chris Titko is our musician. Ray Comstock is the master of our audio and video, as well as editing. And Bonnie White takes all the pieces we give her and masterfully puts it all together. Monumental has been blessed with this talented and gifted team. Let us now prepare our hearts and minds for worship and receive the blessings of our loving and merciful God. Inch by inch, row by row, gonna make this garden grow. All it takes is a rake and a hoe and a piece of fertile ground. Let us sing together, When Morning Gilds the Skies. If you have a hymnal at home, it is 185, or follow the words on the screen.
Jesus.
together. Dear God, thank you for all that is good, for our creation and our humanity, for the stewardship you have given us of this planet Earth, for the gifts of life and of one another, for your love, which is unbounded and eternal. When we have wounded your love, heal us. When we stumble in darkness, give us light. When we forget that we are your home, dwell in us. Living flame, burn in us. Cleansing wind, blow through us. Fountain of water, well up within us, that we may love and praise in deed and in truth. Amen.
Our scripture lesson this morning comes from the first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 1, starting with verse 3 and going through verse 13. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be a dome in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." So God made the dome and separated the waters that were under the dome from the waters that were above the dome. And it was so. God called the dome sky, and there was evening and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the sky be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called the seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the earth put forth vegetation, plants yielding seed and fruit trees of every kind on earth that bear fruit with the seed in it." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed of every kind, and trees of every kind bearing fruit with the seed in it. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's sing together, "God Who Spins the Whirling Planets." You'll find the words posted in front of you.
God, Feed us and nourish us as we may grow in your image and in your likeness, and that the gardens of our hearts may flourish and be shared with those we love. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. In our fourth week of this How Does Your Garden Grow worship series, we hear the words of Genesis. When there is separation of light and darkness, the waters are separated on the land, and the land is separated from the sky. All of this is in preparation for the beautiful vegetation that will grow on the dry land. There will be fruit trees and plants that produce seeds. And for the third time, God saw that it was good. I really love how the first creation story flows. It has a wonderful pattern. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning, another day. It's easy to imagine the earliest human beings gathering around the campfire at night, telling the story so that it is woven into the fabric of who they are and who they belong to. The words sink deep into their souls as they look up at the sky with all the stars and the moon, as they give thanks for the day that has now passed, yet look forward to tomorrow. They understand that they are connected to creation, starting with the light and darkness of the sky. There's a lot of study of the sky these days. The Hubble telescope has been a great source for many years of knowledge and discovery. But now we have an even more powerful telescope, the Webb telescope, that has been sending the most beautiful pictures of the universe, some of which are believed to be pictures of the beginning of the universe. There's a lot of exciting research going on in our sky. Next month, Jean-Luc Margot will be presenting a proposal to change the definition of a planet to the International Astronomical Union General Assembly, which is a global meeting of astronomers beginning on August 6th in Cape Town, South Africa. You may go back to 2006 and remember that a new definition of a planet led to eliminating Pluto as one of our solar system's planets. And there was quite an uproar because some people were really upset that we were no longer going to classify Pluto as a planet. They just loved Pluto. But of course, it's part of it was just they didn't like change. So there may be some controversy over something that most of us never even think about when it comes to our solar system. We think defining what a planet is should have been settled a long time ago, but we continue to explore and to learn. Some of the most fascinating and captivating research surrounds the beginnings of the universe, the beginning of matter and energy, and what is being called the new cosmology. Cosmology is the science of the origin, structure, and fate of the universe. And the academic disciplines of physics, astronomy, mathematics, and philosophy, as together they try to explain everything about our world. Cosmology looks beyond what we can see in the sky with the naked eye, or even the average telescope. It seeks to discover what is in deep space, wondering about where we came from, why we are here, and what can we learn from the stars. This type of study goes way back, even to before the wise men who came to worship the baby Jesus. They looked to the stars for guidance and direction, and for answers about who we are and what is our destiny. We've come a long way in understanding our universe since then, but there's still so much to learn. I don't pretend to understand all the complexities of what scientists are learning, but I try to pick up a little bit about what is happening here and there. I am much more well-versed in Star Trek or Star Wars. But I subscribe to Stardate, a journal that's put out by the University of Texas at Austin Astronomy Department, which I have to admit is sometimes a little bit over my head. But at least I can follow when they tell me when the next meteor shower is going to be, or the next eclipse. However, one thing I learned that has totally captured my imagination and spirit is about stardust. It comes from the study of the Big Bang and that all matter was created in that moment. That matter, that dust, has formed and reformed itself into gases, worlds, and living beings. British scientist and theologian Arthur Peacock explains it this way. Every atom of iron in our blood would not be there had it not been produced in some galactic explosion billions of years ago and eventually condensed to form iron in the crust of the earth from which we have emerged. Now, if that's a little bit more than you want to process, I'll put it more simply. Quite literally, human beings are made of stardust. That realization is astounding, but I think it's also quite lovely and poetic. It may be science, but it also reinforces our connection with all things on the earth and in the universe. Let's hear it again. We are all made of stardust. We hear in our Ash Wednesday liturgy and in our funeral liturgy that we are dust, but it's not just dust like you wipe off the furniture. It's stardust. Stardust. Diana Butler Bass says in her book, Grounded, "The first time I ever heard anyone in church say that we are made of stardust was in an Ash Wednesday sermon. It had been a long time since I had taken college science, and I was not entirely sure I believed the preacher. So I started reading and paying attention to new discoveries in physics about the Big Bang and the inflating universe, about dots and strings." Now, I don't know what dots and strings are. When I've watched the TV comedy show The Big Bang Theory, they sometimes mention string theory when they talked about their work in physics, so I guess it's something with that. So some of you might probably be more familiar with that than I am. But Diana Butler Bass goes on with, "Not only were we made of stardust long ago, every day more than 60 tons of cosmic dust fall to the earth, where it mixes with existing soil and enters the food chain. Stardust is a source of ongoing creation. We eat and breathe stardust. Our beautiful gardens, whether they are gardens of flowers or gardens of fruits and vegetables, they are made from stardust. The sky fills and nurtures these gardens so that they can grow to be healthy and life-giving to us and to the world. The sun sends its warmth and energy to grow our tomatoes and cucumbers and to bring beauty to our hydrangeas and daisies and lilies. These gardens give us nutrition and they fill our senses. And it's all stardust. If we have never felt totally connected to the earth, to the animals, the plants, and the universe, understanding that we are all made from stardust, this makes it clear that there is a deep microscopic connection to all things. Stardust is our gardens. Stardust feeds and creates our gardens. Stardust is our family and friends and our neighbors. Stardust is everything physical in our world. But we also feel that spiritual connection. Our personal gardens, the feeding and nurturing of our spirits and our souls, is in the stardust. God created us and fills the depths of who we are in connection with God and with each other. I really felt that this week when I went to Beyond Monet, the exhibit in Virginia Beach. Monet's paintings seem filled with stardust. This impressionist painter began a new style of painting that really wasn't very well received with his blurry depictions of the world he saw. Monet's art doesn't have strict lines or well-defined edges and colors. He blends color and uses broad strokes. And his work is inspired primarily by nature and makes room for the presence of skylight and stardust. Monet was known for painting en plein air. And that's the French for, but in English, it just means painting outside, not painting in a studio. He wanted to see the world in its natural light, not from the changing moods and light of an inside studio. And he was known to say, the real subject of every painting is light. He was also described as an artist who painted the air. He even said himself, I want the unattainable. Other artists paint a bridge, a house, a boat, and that's the end. They're finished. I want to paint the air which surrounds the bridge, that surrounds the boat and the house, the beauty of the air in which these objects are located, and that is nothing short of impossible. In the exhibit in Virginia Beach, it said, Monet strives to seize the atmosphere beyond painting a simple landscape. He wants to paint the air itself. I think he wanted to paint stardust. Claude Monet's life and work was focused on God's creation, and I think he saw the skylight and the stardust. He spoke as a creator in describing his work and his life. And he said, my garden is my most beautiful masterpiece. I would like to paint the way a bird sings. I must have flowers, always and always. I am good at only two things, and those are gardening and painting. Nothing in the whole world is of interest to me but my painting and my flowers. Monet saw with his brilliant and artistic vision the connection of the sky, stardust, and creation, even if that's not how he articulated it, but he presented it in his art. He saw the air, the light, and the movement of God's hand in the world, creating gardens of beauty that also fill us with joy and hope. So how does our garden grow? How do we grow God's love and grace in us? How do we grow in spirit, in understanding of ourselves and those around us and the world that God has created? Like those ancient explorers and the explorers of today, we look to the sky. We look to the sky with all the curiosity, wonder and awe that connects us to all creation. We look to follow Christ, who taught us to find connections with all people in all the wonders of the world. We embrace the poetic image of being stardust and loving skylight so that we know the joy of being a child of God. Amen.
As we begin our prayer time, let's sing together, In Above There Is a Flower, the first verse. If you have a hymnal, it's number 707. Of our summer lives, goings and comings, time to enjoy the out of doors, the water, the mountains, and friends and relatives gathering from distant places. It is time to recreate or recreate and find new energy as you encourage us, especially in the Psalms in Scripture. Last weekend was a time to reflect on human accomplishment, especially landing and walking on the moon 55 years ago. The story has been retold countless times. Music has been written and played and sung commemorating the events, and we have even heard the story of Buzz Aldrin celebrating holding communion on the moon, while some of his congregation at home also celebrated with him. When we're able to recognize our achievements as part of your grand creation, it helps us put into perspective the small parts we play, but the overwhelming sense that you care about each one of us and the ways we are unique and the ways we are connected as one people. Help us understand that we have overused the planet that you have provided for us to live in and to share with other creatures. We have wasted the water, abused other resources, limited access to food, and marked borders of inhospitality. We pray for this world in need of restoration and ask that you provide us with the tools and the intelligence needed to rebuild the world that you created for us. Help us see the oppression in the world that we live in. Help us not to turn our eyes away, but value all because we want your will to be the last word. Make the church be an effective witness to your will. And Lord, we pray our relationships with the folks we know and those we don't know, we pray for all of them. Make them be based on integrity and hope and love. We pray for those who need you this day in specific ways this morning. We pray for healing of body and mind and spirit, and we pray for the ability to satisfy our needs without greed and with the recognition that we may have to limit our consumption for the sake of others. Lord, in our time of recreation, speak to us, hold us accountable, and push us to extend your love to the world. Lord, save us, heal us, and make us whole. And let us pray together now the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
There's a song in every silence, speaking word and melody. There's a dawn in every darkness, bringing hope to you and me. From the past, from the future, what it holds, a mystery. Unrevealed until this season, something God alone can see.
Let us sing together, God Who Stretched the Spangled Heavens. You'll find it on the screen.
Fields of spirit. Plant your rock.